Hey guys, what's up? Welcome back to the channel. It's Cynic Alex, and today I want to give you my first impressions on update 4.4 with the four new Infinity Warps characters that I'm now going to be auto-playing for you guys, so you can take a look at their skills, in addition to the three new uniforms we got, the new World Boss Ultimate Thanos, and the new Arachnite slash Heroic Quest type content. And starting off with the new characters, because I'm sure that's probably what you guys are most interested in, and the only readily available character for all players right away, free to play, Iron Hammer, I have to say I think that they're all quite cool. Netmarble has never been, and the developers have never been bad at polishing their characters so that they look amazing. The artwork is fantastic and the skills look, you know, just great. I'm going to keep using the same words, fantastic, amazing. But it's definitely the case. And, you know, Iron Hammer kind of blew through this stage a little bit faster than I expected. But even at tier 1 with just an ISO 8 set, no obelisk, 15 gears, he does really well. And he's got a great leadership, especially for new players who are new to the game. And Ghost Panther and Weapon Hex are no different either. I think all of these characters are pretty amazing in their own right. I think the only character that I would probably leave out from this list, oh wow, I actually need energy, is Arachnite. And we'll get to Arachnite in just a minute, but I want to just discuss a little bit further. I want to run through one more time, kind of divide the stage up half and half between Ghost Panther and Weapon Hex. In Ghost Panther's case, I just love the way his skills look. They're just amazing, so much fire. This is really what Ghost Rider should look like, and the added slashing and the added Panther attacks, because you'll see him in a lot of attacks, is just awesome, and I think it looks so cool. Another thing that I want to point your attention towards is this little red bubble that you're going to see in the kind of corner of the screen, kind of behind Ghost Panther. I'm not sure if you know what that is, but that is Weapon Hex's 4-star passive, and that is the passive that I thought was incorrectly placed. But no, it's her summon. It's not a summon of the character, it's just a summon that she creates, and that's her fifth skill. It looks amazing. And she creates that summon for whoever on the team is playing, so that makes her a better support character. And it also works if you do a 3v3 rumble in Shadowland. All three characters will have that red bubble, so you'll have three red bubbles. And then it also works, presumably, the same way for Alliance Conquest. And so that does make her a better support character than we thought, mainly because the heal that it offers is applied to whatever character is using it. So the 99% heal is not going to be the case. I believe it's a 6% heal, but the heal is nonetheless, it's 5 or 6%. But nonetheless, it triggers what looks to be 3 times in a row. So essentially what will happen is the bubble will create a green circle underneath, and that circle will indicate that you're getting healed. I don't think you need to be in the circle, but essentially that red bubble, it does do a little bit of damage, but the damage is really not gonna impress you at all. But the healing will, because it's 5% and it triggers over 3 seconds, so you get a total of 15%, at least 15% healed on whatever character is using, you know, you're using, even if you're not using Weapon Hex. And so that's a really impressive heal to just tack on in addition to whatever benefits she's bringing to the team. Now, she doesn't apply any other team buffs. Her buffs on her tier 2 passive are only for herself, so that does kind of limit her, but it does mean that at the very least she's a decent support character if you need healing. Now, the support doesn't apply if she's a striker in World Boss, so it doesn't work that way, but if you're just having trouble getting through a World Boss stage especially, or a Shadowland stage, you can bring her along as a support, and I honestly think that she's going to heal more than someone like Groot. And while Groot does heal more if you have his Baby Groot uniform and you cast his third skill and his fifth skill, if you're just relying on him to come in and strike for you and drop those little bubbles, it's not going to happen very often. Whereas Weapon Hex's heal triggers pretty frequently, and I saw it happen in Shadowland multiple times, and it actually works. In the case of both Iron Hammer and Ghost Panther, they're powerful universal heroes, and I'm just impressed overall with their skill set. Ghost Panther does feel stronger than Iron Hammer because he's a bio subscription character, but Iron Hammer seems like an awesome pickup for pretty much every player should have him. He's got immunity to lightning, which makes him a hard counter to any lightning based characters that don't have penetration, so besides Thor, and because of the fact that all of his skills are lightning, you can very easily scale his damage up with a double lightning proc. damage obelisk. And because he has super armor, you don't need to give him guard break immunity. So I'm really impressed with those three characters. The character that I'm not really so impressed with right now is Arachnite. And from the testing that I did, you know, admittedly only in the skill preview, the reason why I'm not really impressed with Arachnite right now, besides the fact that it's very difficult to obtain him and kind of weird, is the fact that he has, you know, a web skill for 2 seconds. He's got short iframes on 1 and 2. And then basically after that, he doesn't have many iframes or any. He only has a 3 second immunity on his 5th skill. He's got nothing on his 4th skill, nothing on his 3rd skill. And so because of that, he actually leaves himself open to a lot of damage. And then when I checked on his stat pages for his base stats, they're actually quite low for a speed type. Compared to other speed types, like for example Spider-Man, he's got lower HP and lower DPS. His base stats are comparable to Wong at tier 2. He's got 5,500 physical attack like Wong, just a little bit more, and then he's got the exact same HP, under 15,000. So he's less tanky than some of these other characters, less HP than Angel, and with only 2 iframes and only 1 3-second immunity, I really just don't see how Arachnite's going to survive, even with a heal, a 30% heal that triggers every 7 seconds, and then a 25% guaranteed dodge. Just not enough nowadays. You know, Moon Knight's heal seems really good when it's on a 7-second cooldown, but Moon Knight's not used anymore because even with that heal, it just doesn't work. Even Wolverine, who gets a 5-second heal every second when he's below 99%, this is a heal every 7 seconds under 30%. Most characters can one-shot you from full health, let alone getting you down to 30% first. So I really am not sure why they chose this character specifically to be the heroic quest character. For those of you that are curious about what the heroic quest essentially does, is you choose one of the 4 tracks. So you either choose Luke Cage, Jessica Jones, Iron Fist, or Arachnite, and you can't change your track once you've decided. So just try to remember that, and if you haven't chosen yet, because you don't have to, maybe make your decision after hearing what I have to say. And then once you choose your track, you'll have, presumably, always 45 missions to complete over 7 days, and that is the first part of the quest, the heroic quest. After that, you'll see that you'll be able to unlock the next phase after 6 days, 19 hours, and presumably that would be New York, but it might bounce around somewhere else. And you'll have a total of 4 weeks of this kind of style of epic quest. And it's like an epic quest because it gives you these missions that you have to do one after another, and each mission that you complete gives you bonus rewards, and it requires you to play other game modes. So, for example, the first 7, 10 story mission clears, you don't have to use Arachnite, 10 Dimension Rift clears, 2 daily missions, use 300,000 gold, 10 special missions, and so on and so forth. So if you like the style of an epic quest, if you like feeling as though you're doing more for doing the same amount of work that you were doing before, the same amount of daily grinding and just getting some extra rewards on top, this is essentially what the heroic quest is. Now, in the case of Arachnite, you have to pay 750 crystals up front just for the privilege of playing this game mode. And so for this first week, in total, I'm going to be getting 110 Arachnite bios. After the 4 weeks are done and I've completed 4 stages, over a month, I'll get 440 bios. So 440 bios over the span of a month for 750 crystals is pretty poor. Now, you can spend $2 or $3, actually $4 Canadian, to get back the majority of the crystals you spent, because you spent 750 and you're getting back 600. But you're basically paying $4, let's say $4, it's more than that, but let's say you're paying $4 for 400 crystals. Or 400 bios. That's awful. That's really terrible. It's terrible considering that you're still going to need a mega rank up ticket to get him just to 6 stars, and you're also going to probably need a tier 2 ticket if you want to tier 2 him. So that means that you pay 750 crystals, you play through this heroic quest, you have to be mindful of all of the different stages that you do, and you have to play your missions in order. Because if you play your story missions or your timeline battles before your daily missions, you might goof up and then not have enough time remaining to clear these stages. You have to pay attention to that for a whole month. you get 400 bios, and then you have to burn a mega rank up ticket, and you have to burn a tier 2 ticket, and you have to get lucky, because frankly, you could still fail to upgrade his gears to 20 with the 440 bios. It's actually a little bit less, it's going to be 430 bios, because you use 10 to rank him up to 1 star. 430 bios is enough to rank up a character's gears 95 times out of 100, but still, you could get unlucky, and that is just insane to tell someone that they have to spend 750 crystals up front and a mega rank up ticket and a tier 2 ticket just to get a subpar or even just an average speed type hero. It's just not worth it, and I strongly recommend that you guys consider, you know, very carefully whether you need Arachnite or not, because he's just an average speed character at best. I don't think he's going to be shaping the meta in any way moving forward. Who could be shaping the meta, on the other hand, are the three new uniforms. And here are two of the new uniforms. Apparently, purple is kind of the design color of choice for some of these new characters. We also have the Agent Venom, the anti-Agent Venom uniform. And overall, I would say that while all of these uniforms improve their characters, you should get the uniforms that you use the most. So if you use Medusa a lot, even if you're not competitive in ABX, I think this is a great uniform for her. If you are competitive in Extreme Alliance Battle and you're trying to push to be one of the top 16 teams, this uniform may be a must-have because it buffs her leadership to 42%, which is helpful if you're not using Satan and if you are using Quasar for Universal Female Superhero Day. Quicksilver, on the other hand, I don't think he's going to take over Winter Soldier's spot for Speed Hero, but it's a great uniform. It solves some of the issues with his third skill buff. It gives him damage accumulation when he deals damage, and I think it appears to fix the gap in his fourth skill iframe, so you can no longer interrupt him once he starts it. And he also has more damage because of the buff of the uniform and the chain hit damage from the uniform effect. Probably the uniform that you may see the most value from, though, is Agent Venom, especially for those free-to-play or kind of low-paying players who only have a Tier 1 Agent Venom. Agent Venom, while he's good at Tier 1, he doesn't get the heal because the heal is tied to his Tier 2 passive, amplifying his Venom Frenzy 4-star passive to give that 15% heal. But that has changed because when you equip his new uniform, now his first skill, Symbiote Restraint, will heal him for 6% of his HP. And you can do that every 3.5 seconds. So this uniform gives him a lot of survivability. And I think this is a great pickup if you're the type of person who has Agent Venom at Tier 1 and you use him a lot for Shadowland. This is going to make him a beast for Shadowland. And it actually makes him better for Tier 2. Now, again, I don't think any of these characters are going to move up into the meta with these new uniforms. Certainly Medusa's not. Anti-Venom or Agent Anti-Venom's probably not. Quicksilver was already in the meta before his uniform, so I don't think he's going to go much higher. He may jump a couple of spots, but let's be real. Nothing has changed majorly for the character in terms of the way he plays. He's still a DPS first kind of semi-glass cannon character. And so I don't expect major waves to be made by any of these characters, but if you use them a lot or if you love the character, I would say that's a pretty good investment. I don't think any of these are a bad investment if you use the character. But just getting it because it looks nice or getting it because you think it's going to be meta, probably not a good idea. And if you don't use the character, again, be real. Do you need them? Finally, I wanted to cover the World Boss Ultimate Thanos. And I don't have Thanos as my World Boss of the Day, but I have been told and I have seen some Reddit snapshots that or screenshots that show when Thanos is the World Boss of the Day, he gives additional Cosmic Cube Fragments as a possible double drop, which means that you could get your regular Cosmic Cube Fragment drops and an additional drop on top of that. Now, keep in mind that for every other World Boss Ultimate that drops these Tier 3 materials, they only give you additional books and additional dust. The dust that drops is usually 5 to 8 dust. So I'm not sure, I haven't seen anyone who actually got Thanos and got the CCF to drop, but I'm not going to hold my breath that it's more than 10 CCF. And how many times have you played Corvus or Cull Obsidian and you got zero books, even though he was your World Boss of the Day? So while it's kind of nice that they tried in some small way to give us additional CCF. The fact that it's random, the fact that it's tied to Thanos being the world boss of the day is frustrating, and they're really trying to squeeze us for CCF, and I'm not really sure that it's working. I think it's actually turning people off from tier 3-ing more than anything. But the actual stage is very fun. It's very difficult. I played through it on stream, and I had a really fun time because it's frankly savage. Thanos is not giving any fucks, and you will die a lot, which is great. And I can't wait to see how high I can push with Deadpool and some of my other maxed out characters, because I think, you know, north of level 20, it's going to start getting insanely difficult. And I'm saying that as someone who's been able to complete stage 49 of Cull or Corvus. So it's a huge jump from 50 down to 20. But Thanos is making it extremely hard, and I guess that's something that veterans can kind of look forward to. So if you're a new player or you're an intermediate player and you're having troubles with stage 1, don't feel bad. I died repeatedly on stage 1. It's not for new players. It's definitely for those of us who have, you know, very well-built characters and very well-built rosters with lots of support characters and a perfect list of strikers and stuff like that. So overall, I would have to say that while it is definitely a mixed bag, I think the characters and the uniforms are very highly polished. I think that the heroic quest definitely needs some additional components, some additional resources to make it worthwhile, and definitely for the crystal purchases for Arachnite, there needs to be a greater incentive. I don't think it should be tied to how powerful the character is, but I think 440 bios is just not enough. I think they should probably double that, because then at least if you're not going to use the bios for Arachnite, almost 1,000 bios is pretty decent to level up another character if you have a lot of native tier 2s, so it has additional value. But under 500 bios for what's essentially the same price as a uniform just doesn't cut it nowadays, especially with how frequently we get bios from other means, login events, Shadowland, etc. But overall, I would say that I think this is a positive update, and there is some repetitive gameplay that's being attempted to implement in the vein of Epic Quests. And Netmarble sees how much we love Epic Quests, and I think that's where they drew the inspiration for Heroic Quests. So at least they're going down the right path, and there is some sort of positive direction that they're going in. Hopefully they'll improve it with future updates and future Heroic Quest packs, because I don't think the Heroes for Hire featuring Arachnite is going to be the only one. But let me know what you guys think. Sound off in the comments below. Let me know what you think of the four new characters and the three new uniforms, which one you prefer the most. I think I'm partial to my boy Ghost Panther. Subscribe if you enjoy the content and you want to support me. Hit the bell if you don't want to miss any of my videos. And of course, if you like what you see, I hope to see you again tomorrow. Take care.